One, two, three, four. You don't know what you've been doing to me. You don't know what kind of tension this brings, yeah. It's just a matter of time. Everyone's got something stuck on their mind. It's just a matter of time. It's just a matter of time. I don't want to start presenting I'm older. I don't want to write till I can come over now. If it was sin, but I feel more, would you still take control? Did you consider that I might be right for the first time in my life? If it was light, if it was easier to take it all in stride. What's your mind? What's your mind? One, two, three, go. I don't want to start presenting I'm older. I don't want to wait till I can come over now. I don't have the heart to tell you it's alright. I don't have a way to make it seem like I'm working up the courage. I don't want to say what's on your mind that makes you nervous. To hold you tight tonight. It's just a matter of time. You got everything too fucked up to think about it now. It's just a matter of time. It's just a matter of time. Woo! I don't want to start presenting I'm older. I don't want to wait till I can come over now. To tell you it's alright, I don't have a way to make it seem like I've been working up the courage. I don't wanna say what's on your mind and make you nervous. Hoping I'll be there for when you lose it, love it, or lose it, love it, or lose it, yeah. Thank you.
For all four of you individually, was music the first art form that you guys fell in love with? Or was there another creative art form that you fell in love with first, and then you got to music eventually?
Ooh, does Guitar Hero count? Exactly where I came from, I was a Guitar Hero baby. I got too good at it. My dad was like, dude, you need to play a real guitar.
So now I'm not playing guitar at all.
What was the song that was your go-to to be like, you want to see how badass I am at Guitar Hero? Bam, expert mode. What was your go-to?
Not Through the Fire and Flames.
I was waiting for it.
I was not quite to the point where I could nail that every single time. Cliffs of Dover? That was on there?
Okay.
Yeah, that one was just a fucking shred mess. And dope song, but yeah, that was definitely my go-to.
So I got a good story about this. So my brother, he is a really good like artist. You draw, you paint, all that stuff really well. I was not quite as gifted. I did enjoy doing it as a kid. And when I got to college, I took an art class. And I remember I was working on a charcoal drawing, you know, and I worked on it for hours, like, you know, some waterfall, trying to make it all beautiful. And I show the professor, he's like looking at it, nodding his head, and he goes, I see you put a lot of effort into this. And I'm going to be like, all right, well, I ain't an artist. That's all right. I'll stick with some music. So
I don't know it. Yeah. Cool.
Fair enough.
I definitely thought I was going to be like the next dude to put a show on Nickelodeon. Cause in fifth grade, I was really good at drawing, but by eighth grade, I drew like a really good fifth grader.
That's pretty funny.
So how'd you get into playing the bass?
When I was younger, I was a weird kid and I wanted to be weird, and I knew a bunch of my friends played guitar, so I couldn't do what they did. And so I went to the pawn shop after like walking my neighbor's dog for 6 months and bought a P bass for like $60.
Man, 6 months? Bucks a month?
Damn, dude. I walked up. I didn't know what money was. I was like 10. I'm like 50 cents a block. And she's like, yeah, sure.
You got to go to the Department of Labor and Industries and you sue her for back pay.
Karen Wartz, if you're watching this, come.
Come view.
It was definitely music. No question about that. But the way that I got into drums was in fifth grade. Everyone in my school had to play in either band or orchestra. And I thought people playing clarinet and trumpet looked super lame. So I said, I did not want to do that. I convinced my dad to let me take drum lessons because you had to audition to be drummer because everyone wanted to be it. So I took drum lessons for a year, auditioned, got the part. And I was like, I'm going to do it for fifth grade. And then sixth grade, I'm going to quit. Don't care about music. And then that's when I discovered Linkin Park and I'm still here.
Absolutely.
There you go. All right, quick tangent. I got to ask, are those Topo Chicos that you guys are drinking? Is that the biggest
one? Oh my God.
You should ask.
As a matter of fact, yes, they are. Topo gang, baby.
You guys know these things are becoming like super hard to get now with like all the COVID like supply chain issues and stuff.
Oh, Dan knows all about it.
Yeah, we're okay. Right now.
John and I work for Topo Chico. We know about it firsthand. That's why we have some.
I was going to say, that's why I'm sure behind that door, there's probably like floor to ceiling, just hordes of Topo Chicos.
The fridge is stacked.
In case the apocalypse comes. There you guys go. What were some kind of things that you guys as a band either are excited about kind of like resetting or like got opportunities to maybe experiment with or stuff that you maybe wouldn't have done without COVID?
Everybody knows we wrote a whole album in the process. And so that was huge. Obviously, we would have written it anyways, but I think we had a little more time to do it. And we had a little more time to, you know, flesh it out, make it as good as we could possibly make it. And in that process, we also, you know, we've been filming music videos. And I think one of the things that we're looking forward to doing, this might be a little bit of a spoiler, but we're going to change some stuff up about our live performances within the songs. And we've been inspired by a couple of bands who have done that. And that is it's just, you know, part of going the extra mile for shows. And I'm not going to say that, once again, that wouldn't have come out of COVID, but seeing as we had tons of time on our hands and we really tried to make this as good as we possibly could. We know these songs like the back of our hands. And I think the little details like that are going to make all the difference when we do come back.
So going into that further, you mean, are you guys kind of twisting and playing with like different versions of the songs or stuff like that? Or
think like extending bridges.
Ah.
Things like that. Okay. Or extending outros.
Who were the bands that inspired you that you guys saw doing this the right way?
I'm going to sound like a fucking broken record if I say it, but Don Broco. Yeah. we it's like we bring them up every single time we do an interview.
I always like to ask bands or any artist what success looks like for them.
For me, there's two things, but I'm going to omit one of them because I know the other one is Daniel's answer. So I will say the point where we know how many people are going to be at the shows. It's not, you know, obviously we can guess now, but we're at a point where it's always going to be a good show. The bad shows are our great shows now. And not to mention just being within the touring circuit of other big bands too, opening for them, things like that. And I think it's just going to be visually seeing it on tour. Obviously Spotify numbers, Instagram numbers, that's one thing, but when you can physically see the people in front of you really enjoying your music, it's a whole different feeling. And that is definitely the feeling I'm trying to chase and get to.
I'm going to change my answer.
Oh my God.
A little bit. Freaking. Success. There's two stages for me. One, success is there. Okay. Since I'm the money guy, they'll both be money related.
I was waiting for it.
The first one will be when we've been able to pay ourselves enough to where all of the financial investment we've put into the band has officially broken even. And we've paid ourselves $1 each. That's the goal. When we've each recouped every dollar we've put in and we've built a business that's big enough to pay us $1.
Gonna frame that dollar.
That's gonna be straight
up. That's Mr. Krabs dollar on the wall. Right there.
The second one is when we've gotten to the point where we can quit our regular jobs And I know that I've done a good enough job managing our business and our money to where I can pay all of us salaries to be able to do the band full time. Those are my like two next big pieces of success.
And that would have been one of my answers.
Okay, I was gonna ask. So did he cover? Great.
Yeah, absolutely.
Good. Well, no, what you were thinking I was gonna say was when you could make enough money or when I could make enough money. I'm saying when I can make all of us enough money.
That's so sweet.
That's so sweet, Daniel.
For me, success just looks like, you know, kind of touching on what, you know, Daniel said about being able to kind of like not work a day job. Because I feel like if there's one thing that like obviously COVID was like a horrible thing, but one thing that it did allow us to do is like fully like focus. For the first time, I didn't have to get up for work. I just literally was just like, I got to stay at home. What can I do today? I have to focus on writing music. So I think a lot, like I think for me personally, I think every artist says this. I think this latest record we're going to put out is literally our best work because like literally we had a chance to like focus and didn't have outside, you know, sources disturbing us or distracting us. I mean, I was literally just like thinking about this record, thinking of, you know, through the pre-production process, you know, how can I improve these songs? You know, I mean, and we went to the territory of, you know, adding 8 strings, you know, and I think that's like something that maybe we wouldn't have thought of if we didn't have the time to sit and like, shit, man, what can we do to kind of, you know, make this punch you in the face? Well, let's add some 8-string booty, you know?
The too high big brain answer, but it's like, ambition is the greatest enemy of success. Cause like when I was 14, my idea of success is like, I want to be playing that stage at the quesadilla restaurant where I saw other bands playing. And then like when I'm 16, I'm like, I want to go on tour. And then when I go on tour, I'm like, I want to go on tour where people are. And so I think of that like gradually my idea of success, like the more I accomplish, like, I feel like I'm never going to feel successful because there's always going to be that rung up on the ladder.
God, stop.
I know, too. Oh, big brain.
I'm just so contentious. Like, I just want to focus on music.
No, I told you to stop because I'm
never satisfied.
I feel you. Brian. I know exactly what you're talking about.
Second song, what are we getting treated to and what is it?
This is an oldie. Not that old. I mean, 3 years. It's called Fashion Forward.
Open up those eyes of yours to show me what's been hiding underneath. Whoa. If it's games you want, you'll get the best of me. With you looking the way to. So I'll watch you on that stage with that pretty little frame. Oh God, I swear. When I get to run my fingers through that hair one last time. And I'm not here to get caught up in friends. So I'll keep what I can. Do you expect this to end again? Oh, she knows it too. The way she dances, the way she moves. Oh, it's too much to take. I refuse to take just maybe. I'm nothing but a tag in the light. Or am I good enough to be your type? Whoa, I hope you're opening up those eyes just to see this heart on my sleeve. Oh, she knows it's true. I'd give myself up, but would you too? Oh, it's too much to take. I'm bound to break through. I refuse to take just maybe. I'm nothing but a day in the life. You know it's the last thing for me. But I can handle my own peace of mind. I lost the words to describe the look she gave me when she said with her eyes. You swore you were all mine, but who am I to say hello or goodbye, goodbye? come asleep to those open eyes. Our abuse that takes us, baby. I'm nothing but a day in the life. You know, you're not the last day for me. But I've become asleep to those open eyes. And last, for words to describe. Ella, she gave me what she said with her eyes.
Do you have any other band inspirations, or do you follow any other band?
Ooh, that's a great question. John and I are really into a lot of Japanese rock. I know it sounds weird, but it is the funkiest, jammiest shit. And I think, dude, I mean, there's Polka Dot Stingray.
Polka Dot Stingray is a really great band to start with.
Yeah.
It's she's an amazing songwriter, guitar player. There's like, I think there's really a lot of, and a lot of Japanese music in general, like what I found is that there's a lot of like emphasis on like skill.
Oh yeah.
And it's like pretty complicated, but not in a way that's like, super over, sometimes it is overstimulating. Don't get me wrong. There are some bands where you're like, oh shit, I gotta take a break from this. But there are some bands where you're like, man, that is just insane songwriting capabilities. And
yeah,
you know, it's great.
There's Maximum the Hormone.
The Hormone is the one I was talking about, where sometimes it's a little
overstimulating.
For any of you, you know, weebs out there that have seen Death Note, they're like the metal band that does the theme song.
Yeah.
Oh, that's sick.
Yeah.
One of my favorite artists from Japan is a guy named Kan Sano. And he's a little more chill, a little less like crazy rock, but that it's just super diverse, really cool. Anyway, we take a lot of inspiration from that shit. And then of course Don Broco, like I fight. Because I can't not talk about them, I guess.
And we also just put up on our Spotify, we have a playlist called Real Rockers. That's like a collection of all the bands that we're friends with that we like. Not so much musical influences, but bands that
we're homies
like
with. And yeah, go check that out.
Lovely, guys are sick.
Oh, thanks.
Okay,
thanks.
So I got two questions. I got a two-parter. With tours coming back and stuff, do you guys think you're gonna come visit Canada?
I want to.
The next question.
Oh, go ahead.
Thank you. Sorry. And the second question is, what kind of impact do you think, or like, what tips did you learn from like working with people like Fluff and Jared Dines, all that stuff? Did that help with the social media kind of presence or not?
I'll start with the first one. We love to come to Canada. It's all about who we know and whether or not we have booking connections up there. To be honest, the most likely outcome of us coming to Canada is us opening for a bigger tour that's going through Canada. And then your second question, you know Fluff better, so maybe you can.
I think there was a lot of, I've actually known Fluff for a long, long time before YouTube stuff. Like we just, you know, we've just known each other through music and stuff like that. And I think really what I learned a lot is from them about kind of like social media presence is like, engagement is really key. So one thing, if you guys, you know, go on our Instagrams or any of our personal Instagrams, like we literally try to respond to every single comment for a couple reasons. Number one, we give a shit. We give a shit about what people want to say to us and talk. And like, I love that shit. I love seeing people being excited about work that I'm a part of. And then the other part is too, is like you get that engagement rate up and then it gets other people interested and then they want to join the conversation, you know? They see that like, oh, Brian actually gives a crap. Cool.
Gives a crap.
Who is the artist for the She's Quiet acoustic art? And how do I get their permission to use that on a tattoo?
You already have permission to use it on a tattoo. Go ham.
Go do that.
I don't remember her name. It was a couple of years ago and we haven't really talked to her since. And fun fact, that was only supposed to be a tour flyer. But we liked it so much that we used it for the artwork.
I'm sure we could dig it up though.
Oh, like it would take us probably like 3 minutes to dig it up.
We'll maybe dig it up and maybe send us a message about it. And we'll like make sure you like get linked up.
Yes, but you totally have permission to get a tattoo. Absolutely. That would be awesome.
Shoot, I can hear it in my head. I don't remember it by name.
I'm thinking the same thing.
I don't really fuck with In the End. That song got ruined for me just by hearing it too much.
That's the song that got me into them.
Yeah, that's pretty common.
Dude, Naruto AMV's got me into
it. Yo, let's go!
Oh, it's With You, the third track off of Hybrid Theory.
That's a deep cut.
Dude, that opening riff fucking smacks.
That's hard.
That was like in my earliest phase, like I hadn't found real metal yet. So I was like starting to get into new metal. So I was really big on Linkin Park, System of a Down, and Limp Bizkit.
Still am, man.
Still am. But dude, Linkin Park has some fucking riffs.
What conceptual topics do you cover across the songs in Slow Bloom? And what topics do you want to explore next?
Wow. Ooh. That's a deep question. Just plugged in the eighth and I hope it works better. I can talk about that. The album as a whole is kind of about the insecurity of being a musician in general. And to talk in a broader sense, doing what you're passionate about without financial security or security in general, like it's not really knowing what the future holds. You start a new job that you really like and you can pretty much tell what the future is going to hold. Maybe you'll go up in the company. Maybe you'll get fired. I don't know. Probably not. If you're a good worker, I don't know. That's not the point. The point is that doing what you love can be really terrifying. And we've kind of hit that point in our life where there's no going back. Like we are in this now. And obviously for the longest time, we've had that mindset. It's not something that we have ever shorted ourselves on. We've always thought, I'm in it to win it. But now we're at the point in our lives where we have already passed the crossroads. You know what I mean? Like when we hit the crossroads, we decided, okay, am I going to, really hit this hard or am I going to be a normie and go get a job? Like we have already taken the path and that is terrifying for a lot of reasons. All those reasons are different reasons on different songs on the album. But anyways, yeah, that's pretty much what the album as a whole is about.
Will has a second question, which was more of a broad question. Of what are your all thoughts on just the state of modern alt rock in its current form today?
That's a big topic. And, I feel like for me, I think, I'm going to be honest with you, I'm probably pretty ignorant to it. But from what I have picked up on is that, you kind of have artists like Olivia Rodrigo, mm-hmm. you have artists like Machine Gun Kelly, kind of repopularizing a sound that was very, very popular,
15, 20
years ago. And on one hand, I think that's really, really cool that a sound that maybe we're familiar with and maybe we're even kind of a part of in a sense is kind of like on an upward trajectory. And then on the other hand, there is part of me that's like, man, we've been here for a minute. I've been waiting a long time for this. So, I think it's an interesting place to be right now. And I'm curious kind of how it's going to, unfold in the next year or two.
It's a good answer.
A lot of people say that they think, big publications like Rolling Stone, I've seen them have headlines like Machine Gun Kelly is, revitalizing pop punk and it's going to have like this huge ripple effect on the underground like Warped Tour scene. And I don't think that is true at all. I think that they've basically created their own subgenre. And I can't imagine anyone who finds MGK and like Olivia Rodrigo are going to go then turn around and look up Knuckle Puck. Like there's 50 artists who do that genre and they're just going to go listen to all that genre. So like, while it is cool that it's like a revival, maybe people will pick up like Good Charlotte and Blink-182 and like Newfound Glory. I don't think it's going to make its way down to like the Warped Tour crowd all that much. Like All Time Low might see an uptick because they can collab with MGK, but like we're not going to get any fans from it.
Right.
I mean, me saying artists like MGK might be a little offensive in a few years, like the same way people say artists like Paramore and refer to any rock band with a female singer. So like I'm oversimplifying it a little bit, but for like the sake of this conversation, Mod Sun, MGK, that like kind of the emo rap leads into pop punk style, I'm kind of putting that into all one big bubble. And there's, it's hot, like it's hype right now. So there's a lot of artists doing it. And I just don't see how there's going to be a lot of spillover from those artists to like bands with 50,000 monthly listeners.
How's it going, guys? It's me again. Hey. I'm here with my drummer, Tim.
Oh, no. What up?
What up?
Well, our question is, where are you guys from? Because we can't find it anywhere on your social media. But before you get into that question, we just want to say that I was like blown away by your guys' performance. Like, seriously,
you guys are
talented as hell. Yeah. Like, some serious pros right here. And like,
thanks, homie. Really an honor to play with you guys. Appreciate that a lot.
Yeah, we looked up your Spotify. Like, I found your Spotify through Instagram, and your sound. Like, you made like awesome adaptations, like of your songs. Like, looking at your Spotify, it was totally different than I kind of expected, just because of your like acoustic stuff. But it was like really cool because of that.
Nice.
Thank you.
So happy you guys dig it. We are from Seattle. We live here in Seattle. Nice.
Sick. Love that's cool. I always wanted to head out there. I know the music scene's fucking sick because of you guys now.
Oh, shucks.
Yeah. If you're ever East Coast, hit up Blind Drive.
Next spring, there's a pretty good chance we're going to go out there.
All right.
Assuming the country doesn't shut down again.
It's
more like assuming we survive.
This is literally John's whole MO. He just gives out bad jokes that sound like the word you just said.
That's hilarious.
Anyways, thank you guys so much. Damn, and thank you for opening for us. We really appreciate it.
Oh, absolutely. Honor. It's an honor.
So,
two-part question from Corey. When are you guys coming to bless us with your new album in Georgia? And are we going to get another single before October?
To the second question, yes, you will. Probably, as I was saying, next spring, there is a good chance we're going to go that far. This time, the only reason we're not doing anything bigger for this tour is because we're kind of testing the waters because of COVID. Like, we had no idea how it was going to go.
Everything's up in the air.
So we didn't, like, I hate to say it, we didn't want to make too big a commitment to it. When we are planning on doing a full US as well, but this is just like logistically so much easier. And it's going to be our ease back in to the world of touring. So.
Hey, hello guys.
What's up?
I'm from Brazil.
Nice.
Yeah, guys. I'd like to know, now that we know, you were into Linkin Park to make your own music, yeah. Can we expect a heavier sound from here to go on? Maybe more distortion, screamo. What are your thoughts about it?
Yes.
Yes. You should listen to the full album when it comes out in October, because there will be some heavier stuff.
I mean, we're trying to do it in a way that's pretty cohesive with our current sound, but it doesn't sound like a new band did it, but it's definitely heavier. There's one song in particular that I'm thinking of that it's not going to come out until the whole album comes out, but everything, like a bunch of the choruses have 8-string guitar layered behind it. We're just trying to make everything hit harder, basically. So we're not exactly going for like, you know, metal or screaming or anything like that, but we do want to take metal influences because we all did come from metal bands, and we want to mesh that with what we already have going on in a way that is cohesive. So yes, you can totally expect more heavy material.
Yeah, it makes me so happy. Thank you guys. You're awesome. I promise I'll talk about you all the time here with all my friends in Brazil. I'll make you come here.
Hell yeah.
Yeah.
Thank you. Hope to see you soon.
Nicholas, where in Brazil are you, out of curiosity?
I'm from São Paulo.
Ooh. I hear the pop punk scene down there is pretty freaking cool. Is that true?
Yeah, guys. There's one particular band I have in mind I'd like you to check out. It's Gloria. It's actually a band from Rio, but their sound are really great and heavy, and you would like to hear it.
Cool.
Gloria?
Check it out.
Gloria.
Totally. We will check it out.
Nicholas, thanks for the recommendation. All right, I got another question from Amelia, which is, I got two questions. One from Amelia: how did you guys get your start as the home team? What's the origin story? If you were a superhero, what's the origin story?
So John and I used to play in a melodic hardcore band together called Open Fire. And we had known each other from before that, just from our like high school metal bands playing together. John wrote like five pop punk songs on Guitar Pro and sent them to me while we were in that band together. And we just kind of like sent them back and forth and made some rough demos. Then I left that band. We each joined different metal bands and toured with those bands for a couple of years. And then in like 2012 or 2013, we got back together and we're like, let's start the pop punk band again. That's how the home team started.
Yeah. And to touch more more on that, I was in my kind of like new metal hardcore band, and we just finished up like a full US tour, like played like This Is Hardcore and stuff like that. And I had a sit down with them because we're talking about like the diverging path, right? I said, look, I want to go all in. Y'all want to do it. And they all had stuff in their lives. They had careers, they had, you know, wives, whatever, and they all said they didn't want to do it. So when Daniel and I formed this band, it was very much like, I'm pushing my chips all in. Like, let's do this.
Hello. Oh, dude. I don't know if you remember me, but I was at that Chain Reaction private show that you guys had with the when you guys opened up for.
Snap, right? Let me tell you, that day was cool because we got to go to Disneyland
for free.
And that was like, I didn't care. I was like, if nobody showed up, I wouldn't even care. I got to go to Disneyland.
And you got anyone, John, nobody showed up.
For anyone else, so most people don't know this story. So we played our first time playing Chain Reaction. We in Anaheim, which is like historic, like Warped Tour scene venue. We get there and the people at the venue are like, what show is tonight? And so
always a good way to start. Yeah. So
we're trying
not
to,
me.
We're
trying to
and we sold pre-sale tickets on our own merch store. Like we had people coming out. We knew like this is our first time playing this venue. We have to get in touch with our agent. We're like, dude, what the fuck is happening here? Turns out the in-house promoter at Chain Reaction just didn't put us on the calendar. Nobody knew about it. No event pages made, like no pre-sale ticket. We literally had like, there were people that were there to see us like waiting in line, looking around being like, there's no one in line. It's just me. So we ended up, there was no local. No, it was just the tour package. And we were playing for this band called Crooked Teeth. He was opening for us.
Yeah, Tyson's awesome.
Yeah. So we were his backing band. So we literally like loaded our gear on stage, played his set, then played our set, and we were done. But we got to go to Disneyland.
Yeah,
the other day.
Disneyland.
So it was fucking cool.
Disneyland.
Oh, you forgot to leave out. Like you guys went around and talking with everybody. That's when Brian was like, hi. What are you doing here?
Yeah, what are you doing here, man? How'd you find it?
And I was like, I'm here to see you. He's like, what? No way. I'm like, yeah. And then like, yeah, I got to talk with Brian for a lot, for the whole time, pretty much the whole time. Saw your set. And then I had a bounce. I didn't get to talk to Dan or anybody else. It's just, everybody was all hogged up by the fans, by all six people. So you got
right.
Six adoring fans.
There was a couple from Chicago.
Oh yeah.
There were like two, like gray haired adults from Chicago, like in like nice clothing, were there. And I asked them afterwards, I was like, hey, what are you guys doing here? And they said they just Googled events in Anaheim because they were staying nearby. They saw us apparently on, you know, on some website. And so they showed up and they're like, you guys are great. Bought a shirt and left. That's it.
Cool, man. Far out.
Yeah, so that's all I wanted to share with everybody. I wanted you guys to share with everybody else because that was pretty awesome, and it shit happens sometimes, but like you said, the great ones have already passed, so.
We're playing Chain Reaction on our upcoming tour in October.
You think there are locals or it's promoted?
It's been posted on the internet already, and the venue knows about it, so.
Ooh, so we're already doing better than last.
Step up. Yeah.
I'll keep harassing you guys online and your DMs and keep talking to you guys.
Hell yeah. Love it, man.
Thanks for talking.
Appreciate you.
Quickly, what's been your favorite music video to record and why?
Ooh. Oh, I know. Slow-mo.
Yeah.
Slow-mo was so fun.
It was fun. It was a lot of fun. It was pretty stressful for me because I was directing it and in it. But I edited it. And it was... It was just a lot of planning, a lot of coordination, because we couldn't have more than 10 people in that studio at a time. And so with the other three groups of people, it was like over 20 people total, with just the actors, not even including the makeup person and it was just
additional camera guy.
Yeah, camera guy, assistant.
Yeah.
It was literally like, it was just a matter of, okay, you leave this time, and then 30 minutes later, these people are going to show up, and it just everything had to fall in place, and it did. So everything went well. Nothing, no fiascos. We did leave 15 minutes late, but we left behind a case of Topo Chico, and the guy said, we'll call it even.
What tips can you, this is from Austin, what tips can you guys give for making your own music videos, specifically an idea of coming up with a concept and then directing and then editing that so it comes out in your vision?
If you've seen it in a music video, don't do it. I see the same music video get made over and over again, and I love it when people do weird shit. They do like interesting visuals that nobody has ever seen before. Even if it's weird, just to be weird, just do it.
To also add on to that, I think an important thing is that if you're trying to direct, watch your favorite director's movies. And then maybe if a scene strikes you, pause it and look at it for a while. And be like, why does this make me feel this way? Why? What's going on here? What about the framing? What about the set? What about the color? What about... whatever it is, you know, I think it's important to, like, if you're thinking about directing your own video, really, like, really watch music videos, movies, TV shows, and, you know, look at what those creatives are doing and kind of think about, like, oh, that's a really cool shot. And maybe you want to do something similar. Maybe it'll inspire you to do something different, but in the same vein, you know, whatever it is. And also, it helps me, at least, because I think, you know, Brian and I bounce a lot of ideas off of each other. Having someone else in the band who also is a little bit more interested in that sort of medium helps. Just you bounce ideas off each other, and
doing it by yourself is a nightmare.
It's a nightmare. And I don't know how people do all that stuff, you know, by themselves. Like, I think, like, just having an extra person just to talk your ideas over with, totally great. So I think that'd be my tips, is like, really take note of like what certain scenes in movies and TV shows and music videos strike you. And then also really, bounce ideas off with other creatives. It doesn't have to be in your band, just other creatives in general. You know, I think all of us like to talk about our nerd craft. So,
yep.
Could we do two more? We have more prepared.
Of course you could do two more.
Okay. I feel like
say no to that.
I feel like we can't come on a pop punk show and not play She's Quiet, which is not the next one that we have up.
Which is not the next one. But the next one we are definitely going to play because we just released it. 1, 2, 3, 4. Are you here? Wait, what the fuck?
I thought you wanted to be Slow Blue.
Fuck, man, what did I just say? I just
you
did
just
this.
Told us to do Slow Bloom.
You're right, man. One more time. 1, 2, 3, 4. It's more the same. There's no other way to make it like I do. And when it counts, don't let it pass. Make that shit last. Make that shit last. Are you here to win? Are you here to give in? Money's not the problem. You know how to spend it. Catch me if I fall, but push me back into the cold. Cause it's just more the same. There's no other way to make you like I do. And when it counts, don't let it pass. Make that shit last. Make that shit last. I've been staring at the ceiling, all cause I can't shake the feeling that you, you were right from the beginning. That I'd be so disappointed in you. So as a fact, you found out the solution. So I keep all your fear and confusion intact. You're getting old, but what's the point of racing if you don't want to rush things? Cause it's just more of the same. There's no other way to make it like I do. And when it counts, make that shit last. Make that shit last. Ooh.
got this fair one. Woo, yeah! Did it make you feel right when you hit that first try? Oh, tell me you don't wanna know. Ooh, what do you get like when you lose sight? Oh, really don't wanna know. Ooh, 'cause it's just more of the same. There's no other way to make it like I do it when it counts. Word. That's how the song goes.
That's awesome. I just got a nice text from Jeremiah asking how did it all go, and I said, oh, they're still playing. It's not over yet. They got a fourth song. They told me they're fine playing if he's okay with that. So I love that we get one more, and I'll let you guys take it away from here.
Hell yeah. Oh, did you already down tune to the lower tune? This confidence sure is all just so you could be amazed. And I know inside it hurts you to see me so down on myself. It's the thought that you deserve so much more than I could ever own. Maybe I'll take this time, whether you ask me to, I'm back into it. Ready, ready, mind. I can only get so far without your guide. Whether you ask me to, I'm back into it. Ready, ready, mind. I can only get so far without you by my side. It's in my head, I'm waking up again. I lost my way, but now I'm home, still standing under your door. For I am with a plan to leave alone. Pretending I'm still with you time and time again. Why don't you show me a real life with your hands in mine? Maybe I'll stay this time, whether you would ask me to come back into it. I can only get so far without you by my side. Oh, whether you would ask me to, I'm back into it. Let you read your mind. I can only get so far without you.
Amazing. All right, I gotta ask before I let you guys go, because I'm watching the thread just blow up as you play four songs. I'm seeing Jess and Avery say that Christian needs to ask to play Real World, and they're all just blowing up the chat right now.
Why do you do this to us?
I'm okay. Literally saying they're gonna kill us right now.
So this is an answer to one of your earlier questions.
Are you dropping it from
that? No. I didn't say. One of the other things that came up in COVID that we probably wouldn't have done otherwise is set up a Patreon. We had been talking about it in like 2018 or so, and we're like, you know, I don't know if anyone signed up for it. I don't know, like, if it's worth putting all this energy into it. And then once COVID hit, we got back together. We're like, dude, who knows what's gonna happen? We're working on a record. We're not gonna be touring, so like, we're not making any money to pay for stuff. Like, we need to figure something out. And so we're like, let's do this Patreon. And it went way better than what we were expecting.
Yeah, it's gone way, way better.
Like, we were expecting like, you know, maybe 5 or 10 people. And within the first month, we had like 40 people, I think, sign up.
And now we are 80 strong.
Yeah, which is crazy. And we have a Discord server that's pretty active. Those people that are asking us to play a song.
That are bullying us?
Bullying us.
That's what I'm seeing that over here. They said, we just pay to bully you guys. That's what that's all we're
exactly
doing.
Exactly what they pay for. Now that I've had a minute to fumble around, I could probably get us through everything probably except the bridge. Really? Because I don't know any of the lyrics. All right, well, I don't think there's any way out of this, so I think we're just going to have to do as much as we can.
We're just bearing witness in the Pop Punk Park community right now to whatever madness is over in that other Discord you all have.
We have played this a total of one half time because on another stream, they bullied us.
They did this exact same shit.
You've got a secret, I'll turn it inside out. You're sick of waiting, but I think it's your time now. Maybe there's another place that I know. Well, maybe there's another place that we can go. I thought I lost you, but now I'm safe at home. Now the way you look, girl, I'm not alone. Well, maybe there's another place like home that we haven't found, that we haven't found yet. But who am I to know the basics of letting go? Let me get lost today.
A bunch of fire icons, so you guys clearly must have done well.
Check out our Patreon. There's a bunch of really dope benefits on there, and I think the number one best thing about it is
you get to cyberbully us.
You get to cyberbully us
into playing songs
we don't know how to play,
and then we all get to benefit from that cyberbully.
Exactly,
so that's great.
And the cheapest tier is $1. So
home team, Patreon, Spotify, Instagram, TikTok, bully them online, bully them on Patreon, bully them wherever you want.
It only makes us better.
I can do it.
New record, Slow Bloom, coming out October 22nd.
October 22nd. And for all of you, thank you again for joining us. Arrows in Action will be here Thursday night.
Fuck yeah, bro!
Are friends with these guys as well and toured with them. I learned that back.
Bully them.
Bully them.
Bully them. Bully Arrows in Action.
I'm tired of getting bullied. Tell them to play Real World.
Now that's a move.
That's a bully.
Watch them fucking bust it out.
Bust out better than we did.
Shit.
I don't put it past them.
They're such a good acoustic band.
They're so good.
That it, like, they know so many other songs too. Like,
they're a great band.
All right. Well, thank you guys so much for joining us. That was truly a treat. I appreciate you going almost 15 minutes over with two bonus songs. Okay. So thank you so much for that.
Hell yeah.
Well, thanks for having us.
Thanks for having us.
All right, all. Hopefully we'll see most of you Thursday. If not, check out the home team and we'll see you soon.
Yo, bye,
thank you.
Bye.